And for a discussion, we're joined here in the studio by the government's chief negotiator, Miriam Coronel-Ferrer.
You can, of course, join a discussion by sending us your comments and questions through Twitter using the hashtag Primetime, or post them on our Facebook page at ANC247. Madam Chair, good evening to you, and thanks for joining us.
Good evening, Carmina, Tony.
Thank you for joining us on Primetime. Where exactly should the work on the four annexes begin? I mean, when the MILF says there's a technical impasse, does that mean that there has to be some kind of a, well, how do you call it? Like a pre-conference before an actual conference?
No, actually the technical working groups on power sharing and wealth sharing have been meeting for more than 2 months now. It's really just the third working group, which is the one doing the work on normalization, that has met only twice. And the other team that worked on the modalities just met for 3 days and produced the complete draft, actually.
So can we simply say there is no technical impasse?
We may say that there's an impasse over a few remaining issues, which basically means that we have to go back to our principals and find some creative solutions with regards to these remaining issues.
Can you share what these issues are?
Unfortunately not.
All right. Can you just whisper it to Carmina and me now, and we'll shut off the microphones? Okay. So there is work going on. And it's not as if everything was stalled by this supposed technical impasse.
No, no, we made significant progress last week. The draft on modalities was completed, and there's just one kink in that draft.
Which you cannot share with us.
Although I guess to a certain extent these have already been intimated in some of the statements from the other party, but in any case, for the power sharing, maybe I'd say there are about three issues that will need to be sorted out, some more. Wealth sharing, one or two issues, just a little bit. And for the other annex on normalization, just one big issue. Yeah.
Okay. But when you heard the MILF panel say that the meeting in Malaysia ended in a technical impasse, were you surprised? Did this affect at all the mood of the talks?
Well, you see, we were working under some constraints. Actually, we were scheduled to end on Friday, and arrangements had to be made for the hotel on Saturday. And we were working up to about 7 p.m. You know, we had to move to a smaller room because the bigger room was already booked for something else. And people were quite tired. It was a whole day's work, a whole week's work, actually. And when it became too late, just doesn't, you know, no energy left to come back to write a joint statement and even to have the formal closing ceremony. So it's really the constraints. I guess it's only because that was standard practice in the past. Although, again, it's not the first time that that hasn't happened, that the panels actually did not issue any statement.
Okay, so when you heard them say that it ended in a technical impasse, you weren't surprised by it, or were you, or did you feel like
we know that we did a lot of work, and we
and
know
they did,
we're stuck
and
on
they
some
know they,
issues.
They did
yes.
Too. Okay.
So there was really, I mean, the thing to do was to go back to our principals and discuss these matters with them. So
you feel, as Malacanang said, they're pretty confident that whatever impasse this is, that both panels will overcome it. Do you feel the same way too?
Yes, of course. I think both parties really want to find a good solution. Both parties are flexible. Both are willing to make compromises, win some, lose some on these issues. And so there's no reason why we cannot really agree on something that's workable.
Is it really workable that we can look forward to a comprehensive agreement by year end?
Well, by year end, which is about 2 weeks from now, and with all the holiday coming up, that's going to be a little bit difficult. But it doesn't mean that the efforts are not going on. That it's just you know, like the executive order was issued yesterday. That means that the creation of the transition commission is already on track. I mean, we can both start working on the names that we will be submitting to the president. we can start thinking about, you know, if it's going to have an office, where should it be? Should it be in Mindanao, or should the office of this group be in Manila? Then all the kinds of preparations you'd need to make to run a commission to be able to perform its job. So all of these things are going on. We're still studying also the issues where there are efforts also to pass texts, not text messages, but I mean working text language for some portions of the draft. That continues to go on.
In the selection of members for the Transition Commission, the presidential spokesman pointed out that the president appoints 7 out of the 15 members, the rest the MILF.
No, it's not the case. It's a commission created by, there was some slight confusion there. It's a commission created by the president, and the president is the appointing authority, so he appoints all 15 members.
I see. Okay. Because from what I'm reading, and I don't know if this statement is properly attributed to Secretary Lacerda, and he was saying that it's written the president will appoint 7 of the 15 and 8 will come from the
MILF. I did read that, but I think he has made some corrections on that.
So the president appoints all?
All, yes.
Will the president's choices have to consider maybe who the MILF who would be acceptable to the MILF?
I guess the spirit is that we will trust their choice of the nominees. We know the kind of work that's going to be done, so we're sure that they'll be putting in people who are capable for the job, who are people also who are knowledgeable of the whole history of both the negotiations and, of course, the whole conflict. So. Okay. So long as the basic requirements are met, like after all, there are certain qualifications to be able to be appointed to a position. And number one would be like maybe you sort of don't have any court case going on against you and all that. These are just the standard requirements. But otherwise, there's that kind of trust that both parties will be submitting names of people who are very qualified for the job.
Mm-hmm. Would anyone from the current ARMM administration be suitable for a position in the Transition Commission?
I doubt, because like the current ARM officials are, if you remember, they're appointed officials as well. Mm. We still have the OIC government in the ARM as well as OIC assembly until the election in 2013. So I don't think that they... Well, I'm not so sure exactly, but otherwise they'd have to give up one appointment in favor of another. But they do have some job to finish as well as members of the assembly or the bureaucracy that's now running the government of the ARM.
Because I would actually assume that being part of the current ARMM leadership, that these OIC officials would somehow have a stake in what happens to the region once the final framework agreement is achieved, right?
Well, so does so many other sector in that society have a stake. I think we've said that we'll certainly have other sectors represented in the Transition Commission as well, including women, certainly, in non-Moro indigenous communities, and all of that. So we're trying to find a good mix here. But as far as the ARM is concerned, they still have a reform agenda. Remember that part of the reason for the appointment of OIC officials in the ARM is to be able to not only synchronize the elections in 2013, but also to be able to institute the cleaning up of the whole bureaucracy.
Right.
Well, take us deeper into this process. So the process is such that both panels will come up with a short list, and from there the president will choose and appoint.
Right.
But does each panel have a say on what the other panel will do?
No, I think we're operating on trust there. They can give their, they can make recommendations in the same way that we can make our recommendations. Yes.
All right. So there's also another issue here, and it involves the Bangsamoro Transition Commission. I read in a research material that the Government Peace Panel, led by you, wanted the Bangsamoro to lead the Bangsamoro transition. But the other panel, the MILF, is arguing that such a position might just pave the way for a struggle of the fittest, and it might just erupt in chaos, which further prompted Mohager Iqbal to say that he does not believe that the panel, the position of the panel, is the position of the president.
Oh, I think that that issue pertains to the transition authority, which is the other mechanism.
The BTA.
Yes, that mechanism will come into play after the basic law is passed. So the transition commission that's created now, mm-hmm. that by executive order, is the one that's going to draft a proposed law, which will be then be submitted to Congress and then ratified by the identified people in the core territory, prospective core territory, after which a transition period shall set in, mm-hmm. and that's when the transition authority sort of operates until regular elections in 2016. Mm-hmm. So that's actually the, since it's out in the open anyway, mm-hmm. it's actually that issue that's bugging down one of the annexes. Some issues related to the transition authority.
Mm-hmm. And do you see any compromise there?
Oh, yes, we see. Sometimes it's, you know, it's really just a matter of putting something on paper in such a way that the concerns of our respective publics are taken into consideration. And also to uphold important principles that both parties hold on dearly. So it's finding that kind of a good formulation. Mm-mm. So I guess if you're talking about devils in the details, we do need angels advocates here also to help us craft the appropriate language that will pass through the eye of a needle. Mm-hmm. Because if the FAB passed through without much controversy so far, the annexes are even more detailed, and these are four documents. So we are really, really very careful how we craft the language here.
Mm. Where does Malaysia now fit into all of these? Because Malaysia is still the facilitator. Mm-hmm. When the formal talks or the next round of talks begin, how does Malaysia play a role in any of it?
Malaysia will continue to be the facilitator, and the roadmap, which will come out soon with this annex, and actually it's going to be a joint roadmap, unlike the past roadmaps that have come out in the past. You'll see that both the panels and the facilitator will continue to be there until such time all the commitments have been completed and an exit agreement is signed by both parties. Mm.
But as a facilitator, has Malaysia somehow shown some sort of bias, at least for just for the MILF, but not taking into consideration the Philippine side? I mean, how does it work?
Well, we are working very well with our facilitator. He has been very supportive of all these, you know, to and fro communication that we do have to do, that we do, not only during meetings but also outside of meetings. I guess that's very much part of the process, sorting things out so that when we sit down, we are more or less already just narrowing on the really tough issues. So to that extent, we have been working very well with the Malaysian facilitator on these efforts to really pin down and settle all the remaining issues.
Mm. Okay.
All right. Now, you, of course, were part of the panel mm-hmm. When both sides were able to form that framework agreement, a very historic one. The question now is, what's more difficult, that journey towards that framework agreement, mm-hmm. or now that you're at the helm, now you have to live up to the promise of that framework agreement?
Well, the framework agreement is one document. Annexes are four documents altogether. And we didn't have as much luxury of time because we did say we should finish this soon. But then at the end of the day, it's going to be implementation that's most difficult. You can imagine all the kinds of challenges that we'll be facing. when we go through the diverse elements, not only with reference to the political process, but also the elements having to do with security, even economic, because we know that economic development doesn't just happen easily. So all of these will be really major challenges, but if we keep the partnership going, if we, you know, are able to strengthen it and get all the support from the communities and the general public, then certainly it can be done.
All right. Well, it's just going to be 2 weeks until the year end. So I guess for the meantime, you know, both panels cannot really set aside all of these issues, but take it easy for the meantime and go on to the really nitty-gritty work by the year's start.
Well, they said we made them work on their holiday, which was Ramadan and Eid al-Fitr.
Okay.
Yes, we were meeting during fasting month at the time.
See.
So I don't think we have reason to complain if we need to work during our holiday.
So the,
yes.
Oh,
yes.
Well,
see.
It's worth it. At the end of the day, it will be
all right.
Worth it.
Well, whatever the case may be, happy holidays to you.
thank you very much.
Miriam Coronel-Ferrer, and thank you for coming over to Prime Time.
Thanks a lot.
Pleasure.
We appreciate it.